What exactly it means that God speaks to us? How does God speak? Does God have a mouth? Are the actual voices coming out of the mouth of God? How do I hear a divine voice? Well, really no answers. But that is an irrelevant question. Because speaking is really communicating. When we can communicate in many different ways. We can communicate in the easiest way by simply talking. I speak to you, you hear me. Provided I speak the same language as you, and provided you're familiar with my vocabulary, you can understand what I'm saying. You may agree, you may disagree, but that's what you heard. And then you'll judge that. I can also talk to you by means of sign language. Sign language, provided that you recognize these signs. How I do that? So I do not have to speak with a physical voice. For that matter, I do not even have to use sign language. There's such a thing as telepathy, where I can read your mind and I can place, for that matter, thoughts into your mind so I can communicate with you on a completely non-physical level. Some people have that gift. Very few. But it is there. As long as this communication, the only problem with communication and revelation is many people think that they hear voices. Normally you come across a person who claims to hear voices. What do? We send them to a psychiatrist. Hearing voices is the first symptom of schizophrenia. Is it possible that these people do hear voices? Whether they hear them with the physical ear? Every word that you have ever spoken, every word that any human being has ever spoken, is still floating around in the air. You can still today hear anything that has been spoken over the past 5,770 years. Once when mystics used to say that, people used to laugh, you're crazy. Today, of course, we know different. Today we know that speech is not just breathing, exhaling. Speech is a physical reality. When we speak, we create sound waves. Sound waves are real. They're physical. The proof you have, you can sit in your basement somewhere, turn on your radio or your television, and pick up what somebody is talking on the moon. Therefore, communication, passing on a message, I don't care how it happens. What is important that we know that it does happen. So how does God communicate with man? Physical voice? Could you have picked up any of these revelations on a tape recorder? Frankly, I really don't know. But it's irrelevant to me. If I tell you that I have the power of telepathy, and I can communicate with you through my mind, and you, of course, are skeptical. I've seen from the past, people are skeptical when I claim that. I don't know why. Oh, you have little faith. And then I said, I'm going to prove it to you. And how am I going to prove it to you? I said, will each one please here take a piece of paper and a pencil? And when I say, like, go like this, write down whatever comes to your mind. And then I do so, and you write it down. And if somehow everybody writes down exactly the same thing, and before you tell me what you wrote down, I'm telling you what you're going to write down, what you wrote down, would you then believe that I have the power of telepathy? Not only that I can read your mind, but also that I can even make you think. You know, it's communicating and have you express that. Of course, you have no choice. Could there be some other explanation for that? On the basic empirical level, no, there isn't. Is there some far-fetched possibility? Yeah, you can come up with all kinds of theories, but technically, for all practical purposes, you would have to accept that. So maybe God communicates that way, that somehow he is able to put one and the same identical thought in everybody's mind. So how God communicates, what is divine speech and all that, is totally irrelevant to me. If, however, at a certain point, there is this communication, then this has as much validity as you seeing me standing here in a body in front of you and hearing my voice with your ears, seeing me with all my emotions, and say, yes, that I saw, that I experienced, that I heard. So the same would apply, even if that is on a mental level. The get back to our topic. Revelation is the ultimate and final, most important part of religion. Now, revelation can be in many ways. Sydney is a huge city. So is Melbourne, and so is Toronto. And we have all kinds of very fancy modern institutions for all kinds of purposes, in which we provide for all the needs. We have the technology for literally everything. And we have factories, we have computers, we have hospitals, you name it, whatever society could possibly need, we have it. And in every society, of course, we also have some crackpots. At least those people that we like to call crackpots. Who do I call a crackpot? Anybody disagrees with me. They're awfully stupid. They have no intelligence. They can't see reality for what it is. How do I know? Because I know this what reality is. He doesn't see it my way. He's an idiot. And especially when it comes to situations where somebody will suddenly pop up and say to you, guess what? I had a tremendous experience. God spoke to me. What would your reaction be? Shrug your shoulders. Never. Rahman has pity on this fellow. And you write him out or give him a phone number, the nearest psychiatrist. And if he goes to the psychiatrist, what's going to happen? The psychiatrist is going to examine him and he will claim to the psychiatrist, yes, I hear God talking and God gave these instructions, God said this and God said that, etc., etc. And the psychiatrist sees he can't make heads or tails out of this guy, he can't straighten him out, he's going to commit him. On the other hand, in Toronto at least, we have great respect for people like that. Like for practically no one else. When people come and claim that God speaks to them, we take care of them. We give them free room and board. Won't do it for anybody else. So obviously, we care about them. Moreover, people like that who claim that God speaks to them, sometimes you may decide, did he really? Well, we have all different kinds of ways of testing things. We give them a polygraph test, give them a truth serum, who knows what else. And guess what? 99% of them pass the test with flying colors. They are speaking the truth. Polygraph tests are accepted in many places in the illegal system. Which means if these people claim that God speaks to them, pass this test, and are telling obviously the truth that God spoke to them, you have to take their word for it. Since these people are telling the truth, I now have a dilemma, a very serious dilemma. And this gets to the very core of our problem we're discussing tonight. When I go to this hospital for the mentally, well, today it's called mentally challenged. Careful, this vocabulary be politically correct. The mentally challenged. And I go to room number one and I meet patient A. And I ask him, and he has passed all the tests. And I ask him, tell me, what did God tell you? He will answer me, very nice that you come to ask, I've been waiting for you, it's about time. God told me to pass on the message to you that next time you worship, make sure you stand straight, feet together, hands fall down, close your eyes, stand there in awe and trepidation, and worship God. Thank you very much. Then I go to patient number two, and ask him, what did God tell you? God told me next time you worship him, make sure you lie on your tummy. Room number three, make sure you lie on your back. Room number four, make sure you somersault, and while somersault, you say your prayers. Meaning in plain English, everyone will give me some kind of a different message. Whether it differs drastically, radically, or it differs only in minor details, doesn't matter. The messages are not the same. What do I do now? By everything available to me, they are all speaking the truth. By the standard that I measure truth, they all measure up. But they are mutually exclusive. If I follow one, I have to reject two, three, four, and everybody else. If I follow two, I have to reject one, three, four, five, and everybody else. I really have only two alternatives. Accept all of them, and then I really need a psychiatrist. Even I would admit it. You go crazy. Or the other alternative, reject all of them. There's no way I can determine who amongst all these claimants for truth is really the true one. There used to be a television show called To Tell the Truth, where you have a panel of about 4 or 5 people, and then you get, how did it go again? 1 or 2 people that show up on the panel, or one of the even long, and you have to guess what his profession is, something like that. I forgot the details, this goes back years and years. And you ask him all kinds of questions. No, sorry. There is a person that you know the identity, but you don't know who of these people have this identity. And then you have to ask all kinds of questions, cross-examine them, and figure out who it really is. It's called To Tell the Truth. Each one is, of course, going to pretend to be one and the same person. You have to figure out who's telling the truth. That television game is really based on reality. That television game is based on the pursuit of religion, without those people knowing it. Because religion is precisely the same thing. You have a whole panel, and not just of 2 or 3 people, claiming to be one and the same, but having hundreds of people. You have a whole supermarket display of different religions, each one claiming to be the one and only true one. Each one claiming, I am the one and only way to salvation. I have for you the one and only true expression of God's will, how God wants to be worshipped. If you believe one, you have to reject all the others. If you choose another one, you have to reject all those. But all of them have exactly the same claim. How can you ever determine what religion to follow? So therefore, the best thing to do is say, a plague on all your houses. It's impossible to determine. I want to have nothing with any of you. That is if we go by one of two things. Determine religion on the basis of what appeals to you, on the basis of that which you think that's what religion should be like. That's what salvation or a savior should be like. That's what the message should be like. And I heard this preacher, and I heard this so-called prophet, and I really like him. He's a really charismatic individual. And he's so beautiful, and the message is so beautiful and so heart-stirring and so inspirational. This must be it. People are turned on by all different kinds of things. Yes, you're turned on by X. Somebody else is turned on by Y. Same way as you're turned on by X. So why should you go follow X? Why not Y? Well, he turns me on. Yeah, so are you telling me that you are telling the truth and he's telling the truth? And that is essentially the problem with all religions in the world. They're totally meaningless, worthless. They're all basically claiming, on the basis of a person, an individual comes around, I'm a prophet, God has spoken to me, this is the message. If you accept any one of them, you're literally stuck with all others. Unless you can show that one of them has something unique, essentially different, objectively different than all the others. But in terms of who the prophet is, or in terms of what the message is, you will never get it out of that. And therefore, religion cannot be based on faith. Did you hear what I said? Religion cannot be based on faith. With faith, you can adopt literally everything and anything on earth. From the most subtle and most sophisticated ideas, all the way down to the crudest. On the basis of faith, I can give you the most sophisticated apologetics and analysis, reason for the crudest types of behavior, Satanism or whatever you want. I'll show you how Satanism makes sense. It may not be popular, it may not be politically correct, but it makes as much sense as 99.99% of all the other religions in this world. The foundation and the basis is exactly the same. An individual showing up, claiming, I'm a prophet of God. I've been sent by God, and this is the message. For that matter, they may even perform all kinds of miracles, supernatural feats. Every religion in the world claims that it has some of its founders or others of its prophets that perform supernatural feats. And they're correct. They're correct. Are miracles a criterion? Well, if he's not the prophet of God, how would he have been able to do so? Only God can give you that power to supersede nature. But then again, have the other religion doing the same thing?